Every year, there's always one or two cock-ups, and a grand and wonderful author that we've been in dialogue with fails to get their visa. This year, very sadly, it's Niall Ferguson. I have to say, I was looking forward to Shashi Tharoor taking on Neil more than anything else in the entire year, but we'll get it next year. I promise you, next year we will repeat that session. Irving Finkel is not Niall Ferguson, as you can see. However, he is a very, very wonderful speaker. Each year, because there is inevitably one or two dropouts, I always canvass my friends and family of whose lectures they've most enjoyed. And one after another, they came back and said Irving Finkel. His sessions on Noah's Ark has been absolutely spectacular. He's been a witty and a wonderful moderator in several other sessions. And I've actually managed to miss them all, so I'm taking this on. By popular vote of my immediate family circle, we bring you Irving Finkel on the world's worst script, Cuneiform.
Ladies and gentlemen, is this working? I knew this would happen. What a festival. Ladies and gentlemen, I am your afternoon cock-up. Well, I have to admit various weaknesses and failings in my career. I am, in the first place, a museum curator, which is a very embarrassing thing to admit socially. And I work in the British Museum, which is portrayed on the screen in front of you. Now, I need to explain a few things, because I grew up in a family in London which was very unusual in many respects, one of them being that we used to visit the British Museum even when it wasn't raining. And the consequence of this protracted exposure somehow influenced me to decide by the age of 9 that I wanted to be a museum curator when I grew up. And I'm afraid to say, that is what happened to me. But fate intervened in the most mysterious fashion. Now, I know it is the custom in India for a grown man to admit who has been his guru. Well, in point of fact, I have 3, and I'm going to introduce you to them one by one before we get on to the miserable and laborious question of this horrible writing system. By the way, I think you have to realize that there are so many people all around you that you cannot move away even if you want to. Next slide. Am I doing this? Yeah. Hello. Right. Well, this is my real guru. His name is Wilfrid Lambert. He is unfortunately deceased. Now, let me explain what happened to me. I had to go to university, of course, in order to study to become a curator. And I wanted to be an Egyptologist, because I really like ancient writing, which is difficult. So when I went to university, I turned up the first morning for a lesson in Egyptology. And the following day, the Egyptologist dropped dead. And so the head of department called me into his office, and he said, well, you're obviously interested in this sort of ancient stuff. We have in our department this Professor Lambert. Why don't you do a bit of Assyriology with him, and then when we get a new Egyptologist, you can change back. Well, I'd never heard anything about Assyriology, so I went and knocked on the door. And like most English professors, he said, enter! So I went in the room and I said, I would like to study some Assyriology with you. And he said, oh dear! And this was a time when professors in British universities prided themselves on never having students at all. Nowadays, they have as many as possible so they can extract money from them. So this was Professor Lambert, and he taught Sumerian and Akkadian in Babylonian cuneiform writing. And I went and attended his class again for one morning, and then I knew instantly, the minute I saw this material, this was my life's path stretched ahead of me forever afterwards. And I was 17 then, and I'm now 64, so far, so good. Right. Please, anybody can be 64, there's nothing to it. This is my second guru. This is an example of a Sumerian. So this man lived in ancient Iraq in about 2800. He's a priest. He's a priest. What? This mic doesn't work at all. Try this way. Hello. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Do I have to start all over again, or can I carry on? Okay, so listen, this is very serious, no mucking about. This is a Sumerian priest. You can tell he's a priest, he's rather overweight, he's rather complacent, his hands are folded over his ample belly, he has wide eyes and big ears, and he was one of the people in the world who spoke the Sumerian language. Now, nobody in the modern world speaks Sumerian. It's been dead for a very long time. And unlike any other ancient language, it has no relative. It's all on its own. And we had a meeting the other day. Somebody said if they had a time machine to go back to... I'm not coming back next year. I don't know what you tell me. I just wanted to say this. There was a meeting on a platform and somebody said they didn't want a time machine to go back into antiquity because they wouldn't know what to ask. Well, I think that's really stupid because I'd really like to have a long conversation with this guy because his language is very bizarre. So he spoke Sumerian, okay? There's going to be a test at the end, so concentrate. This is a Sumerian speaker. This is an Assyrian or a Babylonian speaker who came later. So there were two languages, Sumerian, unrelated to anything we know, and Babylonian or Assyrian, which is a Semitic language related to Arabic, Hebrew, Ethiopic, Amharic, all the modern Semitic languages, but it's completely dead. You will notice that the Assyrian, tall, handsome, long hair, long beard, very intelligent. You can see the sort of tradition that's involved in Assyriological research. Next slide, please. Okay, so this is the picture of the landscape in which this first writing system came into existence. So this is southern Iraq, which is of course fed by the Euphrates and Tigris rivers, and the banks of those rivers were lined with a certain kind of clay, which right at the beginning of writing turned out to be an ideal medium. And so all the writing for more than 3,000 years was done by pressing a stylus like a chopstick into a piece of prepared clay and using the signs to spell words. Now, you might think this is very dull and boring. You might be regretting you're still here, but let me tell you something. If you write on clay, like these guys did, it lasts forever, okay? The first inscriptions are from 3,200 BC, and they are still going strong in the British Museum. All the books in the British Library are falling to pieces, ha ha. All the medieval treasures, all the bindings in leather, special little insects are nibbling away, but there is no clay-eating insect. So in the British Museum, we have 130,000 tablets in our collection. If we spread them out, they would probably fill the entire auditorium, not that we're going to do it. So they wrote on clay, they dried it in the sun, it became perfectly handleable. Once it ended up buried in the ground, it lasts for millennia and millennia and millennia. So this means that the kind of stuff you'd never expect to find in writing survives. The most ephemeral material comes down to us to be deciphered. It's not like the Egyptians. The Egyptians wrote lots of things on papyri, very interesting. They're all about death. They buried them in tombs. They're all incredibly boring because ancient Egyptians are very boring. You know what they look like? They all look like this. And all they care about is death. But in Mesopotamia, whole different situation is to do with life. So when you wanted to write one of these tablets, you got one of these beautiful bamboo things, cut it straight, got a nice firm writing stick, and away you went. So, next important thing you must remember for the rest of your lives. Writing begins in Iraq in about 3,200 BC or 3,300 BC, in other words, well over 5,000 years ago. And the Sumerians were the inventor of it. Anybody who wants inventions like gunpowder, very boring indeed. This was writing for the first time, the biggest donation that's ever been given to the human race, because where would we be without it? So, when this writing started, as you would expect, it was kind of pictographic. In other words, the first scribes, when they made the first signs, drew pictures of things to represent what they meant. So you can see probably here very easily that the ear of barley, which we have a helpful photograph of, is drawn on the tablet in clay where it stands for barley. The thing next to it is a few numbers. And the same way, at the bottom you can see a man's head with a bowl. This is a symbol for rations. And the one above, perhaps the most important, is a jug, which you can stick in the ground because it has a pointed bottom, which is the sign for beer. So the minute writing starts, there's a jolly good sign for beer. So if you have a writing system like this with drawings that might be done by a 3 or 4 year old child, this is very good if you have the most elementary messages. But if you want to write proper narrative, if you want to say this lecture is frightfully boring, I wonder whether there's any tea left in the tea urn, you're going to have a lot of difficulty. And what happened was this, the next important fact. The next important fact was this, that somebody in that community who was using this system for the inland revenue to record ins and outs and to make totals of who owed who what, it was all on that level, somebody had the idea, which is really of inestimable importance, what we might call the giant leap for mankind. Because somebody thought this, that you could write a sign on a tablet, you could draw a sign which didn't mean what it looked like, it meant what the sign, the word, sounded like. So that you could use a whole sequence of pictures where the imagery was nowhere relevant, they were just used to record sound. For example, the sign for barley, which I showed you before, in the Sumerian language is pronounced sheh, for spelt as it were, S-H-E-H. So if you want to write barley, you draw the barley. But if you want to spell a word like shepherd, for example, in English, you could write the first syllable with barley, and the reader would use it to read off the sounds of the words. This was a very, very important thing, much more important than landing on the moon. Now, anybody here who's under a certain age, who has one of those monstrous mobile things, will be very familiar with this kind of writing themselves, because this is exactly the sort of thing that the Sumerians did at the beginning. They made simple puns or rebus writings. So I dare say for people of my age or more, it is possibly necessary to explain that B4 is like B and 4 is the number 4. So the thing on the right is B plus leaf, that's to say B leaf, and so forth and so forth. This kind of thing, which seems to have made a new entry into the world and been discovered as a new discovery, is in point of fact how writing really got off the ground. Now, next thing. Imagine you're developing a script. You've got lots of signs that used to mean just what they look like. Now they mean sounds as well, so that you can spell the words by ear. If you're making up these signs all the time, this is going to be very important. People would say, how do we write telephone? How do we write computer base? How do we do anything with this writing system? And there must have been people who thought up a new way of writing, and then they had to be written down, otherwise everybody would forget them. So the consequence of this is that right at the beginning of writing, by 2800, we have the world's first dictionaries. And they arranged everything in a very systematic manner so that information could be retrieved. So you have writing and then the development of numbers and then the development of dictionaries in one big wedding cake. It is the most extraordinary thing. Now, what happened if you were going to learn cuneiform? Well, the first thing is, if you wanted to learn cuneiform at school, you had to be a boy. They didn't allow girls in. I'm sorry to have to say this. It's rather embarrassing, of course, but that is the lamentable truth. Now, they had a rather good way of teaching at school, because there'd be a group of children who would come in aged about 8. There would be the teacher, and there'd be a couple of monitors who did all the work. So the monitor would take a ball of clay from the river and smooth it in his hands and make a kind of cake like these. And he would take his writing stick and draw the rulings across and then put the signs in position. So this is one of these tablets where the front was written by the monitor, and it's a proverb. And the younger boy had to look at this long enough that he could remember it by heart, and then on the back of the tablet he wrote the same thing by memory. And then the teacher would come round and intervene. Now, they had a very good system in ancient Sumer. This is in about 2000 BC, a very good system which has fallen out of use in Britain because teachers used to have heavy, long, thick sticks. And pupils who didn't work properly were soundly beaten. And lots of research has established that physical violence is a very good way to make people concentrate on learning. So I've been agitating all over Britain to get this reintroduced in schools, but so far it hasn't been very successful. So this is an example of one of these school texts where the writing on the back, as you will immediately notice, is rather inferior in comparison with that on the front and probably led to a bit of a clip round the ear. Now, anybody who knows anything about ancient Mesopotamia knows what this is. This is the so-called Code of Hammurabi, and it's carved on a large piece of diorite. You can see from the size of the people how big it is, and it has a law code written in the 18th century by this king to lay down how people should conduct themselves. Now, this thing is rather marvelous. This is in the background at the time that school tablet was written. And you can see on the right, some of that shiny picture is some of the writing. And it's rather peculiar because the writing is at right angles to how we would normally read it. So it's evident that those people who were looking at it cannot read cuneiform script. By the way, we had a meeting on stage the other day about repatriation. And it's a dodgy subject. Of course, I'm not allowed to talk about it, so I will. But I just wanted to say something illustrative about this matter and how insane it is. Because once somebody wrote a very fierce letter to the British Museum saying, you must return the Code of Hammurabi to Iraq. And it was lots of exclamation marks and things like that, handwritten with bloodstains. Well, the thing is this. This object was excavated in the 19th century in Iran. First point. Secondly, it's in the Louvre. And thirdly, the reason it's in Iran is in the 14th century BC, Elamites did a raid over the border and stole this from Babylon and took it back to Iran as war booty. So the legal fact is it was nicked in the 14th century BC. So you have to be a pretty deft lawyer to make a really good case for the British Museum returning that anywhere. Now, talking about schools, this is a great rarity. You're extremely lucky to see this. Probably also you'll be telling your grandchildren about it from now on. So this is a close-up of one of those round tablets, and it is a caricature drawn by a pupil. Now, the pupil is probably about 9 years old. He's sitting at the back of the class. He doesn't like the teacher, and he takes his writing stick and, for most immoral reasons, draws the face of the teacher. How do we know it's the teacher? Well, look carefully, okay? You see the nose has got hairs sticking out of it. And right at the bottom, there's a mean, nasty, weasel-like mouth, which I think is very expressive of his feelings about his teacher. So I'm putting this forward as the first caricature in the history of the world which has been preserved on one of these throwaway ephemeral school tablets for us today. Now, I could talk to you for days on end, but I decided what I would do is pick half a dozen rather juicy things to show you with the ambition of making, as I said yesterday in my lecture, each person in the room inhale a gasp of air in surprise. It doesn't have to be shock, it doesn't have to be health damaging, but it needs to show me that you are listening and taking things on board. For example, this is a piece of royal correspondence, okay? It is a cuneiform tablet written in cuneiform script, and it was written by a king in Syria called Tushratta. Again in the 14th century BC. Now, Tushratta was a king of some power, and he had a rather dishy daughter. Now, the voracious king of Egypt, who liked collecting beautiful girls, decided that this girl should enter his harem, so he made business overtures to Tashratta and promised him, on the basis of this letter, it is very clear, promised him a large payment of gold for the body of the girl, plus the spirit inside it. So it's clear from this window which opens on this sordid matter that the pharaoh has long had the girl under his control and in his possession, and Tashratta is writing a rather snappy letter saying, "Where's my gold?" And he spoke a language called Mitannian, okay, in the middle of the second millennium in Syria, and the Egyptian living in Egypt spoke Egyptian, so he couldn't phone him up, so to speak, because they had no common language. So they employed a Babylonian, and there were lots of Babylonians who wandered around the world doing this kind of moonlighting, who worked for the court of Tashratta and dictated a letter. So you have to imagine the scribe sitting there with his stylus and the pharaoh saying, "Oh, and you can tell that rogue that if I don't get that money soon, we're going to go downriver with an army." "No, just a moment, Your Majesty. Dear Your Majesty, how are you? I hope you're well. Your mother-in-law is well. Your camels are well. Everything is perfect. With regard to our recent agreement, and what must have happened is the king walks up and down letting off steam, and the scribe, who understands Mitannian, puts it into diplomatic Babylonian on this tablet. Then a court runner goes from Syria to Egypt with this message in a bag, arrives in front of the pharaoh, who probably thinks, oh no, when he sees one of these damn tablets, but calls for the court interpreter, saying, "What does he want this time?" So the Babylonian reads out this letter into Egyptian for the benefit of the king, probably also being a little bit more diplomatic than it really was. So when all this had happened, and you can see, as a means of communication, it's rather leaky, it had to be filed in the bureau at Amarna for reference. And the local scribe has written in hieratic Egyptian, in ink on the bottom of the tablet, what it's about. So we have a single document with Babylonian writing and Egyptian writing on together. It's a kind of miraculous thing. And when we read it, the whole of this diplomatic correspondence comes to life, and we can see the old tussle between beauty and money is alive in those early days. Now, next thing here, there's lots and lots of magic. There were all sorts of professional magicians who knew spells and rituals and things for all sorts of purposes. But one of the common things they had to do was to get rid of ghosts. People felt that the ghosts were always around and there was always a reason for it. And professionals were called in to exorcise these ghosts to leave people in peace. So this tablet, there's a photograph, I don't know if you can see anything of it, but on this tablet there's a remarkable thing, because the exorcist in charge of this matter has written a kind of instruction book what to do to get rid of a ghost. And he's made a drawing on the clay so that somebody who follows him can take clay themselves and make a three-dimensional figure, which they then use in the ritual. It's a kind of instruction manual. And what he's done, there's a lady and a man. So the ghost in this ritual is regarded as a lady who is unhappy and troublesome. So the idea of the exorcism is this, that if she's unhappy, what she needs is a lover. So they make a figurine of the woman, and behind her, with his hands, you'll notice, shackled on a lead, is this new playboy who is going to be given to the ghost, and they both get put in a boat, which is then put on the river, and off they go over the border, and they never come back, and she is, after all, satisfied. So this is a rather interesting thing, to have a drawing of what to do, and also to have this, what seems to me, a very accessible human idea, that ghosts are, in a way, they've got their needs, they have to be looked after, and if they're looked after, they too will be happy in the future. So now I bring you to the most important room in the world. This is the arched room, which is the heart of the British Museum in London, and you will see from this pigeon's eye view, that the arches give the name to the room, and that it's lined with cabinets full with drawers. And in this collection, we have 130,000 pieces of clay, almost all of which came to us in the 19th century. So, well, that's not very good. One of the highlights of the collection is this. We have the royal library of King Ashurbanipal, who was king of Assyria in the 7th century BC. We have 20,000 tablets from this king. Now, this is a very important step in the evolution of human thinking, because this king had an idea as follows, that all the knowledge which had ever been collected from all time should be brought together under one roof. And so he sent messengers round the kingdom to take tablets from libraries and from collections which they didn't have and bring them to Nineveh. And eventually, most of them came to London. And we recently made a display in the museum to give some idea of what it looks like. Now, we call this the Library of the Assyrian King. And when we made this new display, we had an idea that if we call it a library, no one is going to have any idea what we mean, because it didn't look like a library when it was exhibited before. So we had this idea. We had a shelf along the top with, as it were, spare tablets, and then they were divided into columns about collection and study and research, and with little bits of translation of some of them to give an idea of what a library was. Now, this is a good illustration of how mad the world is, because we've had these tablets on exhibition for 150 years. And the first time we decide to profit from the existence of real libraries outside in order to explain what an ancient library was like in Assyria is the very time when libraries all over Britain are being closed down. So in another 20 years, there won't be anybody under 70 who even knows what a library is full of normal books. This seems to me a matter of painful irony. So this is what the library tablets look like, the most beautiful writing. There's a thing on the bottom that says, it belongs to me, and anybody who takes it away will have a very miserable time. And on the right, there are a couple of clay tablets from this library, where the bit at the bottom, the message that it belonged to the king himself, they let the tablet get too dry, and so they wrote it in a kind of ink. Okay, never mind that, never mind that. I said, never mind that. Now, in this library, there were 20,000 tablets. And at the end of the Assyrian Empire, the Babylonians from the south of Iraq and the Medians from Iran worked together to conquer Nineveh once and for all. And when they invaded the city, they sacked the palace and everything was burned. And this is another example of Assyriological irony, because a library of 20,000 tablets has nothing to fear from fire. As a matter of fact, it is rather beneficial, and it's the only kind of library in the world which is not dreaded by librarians. So when they excavated these tablets, most of them were very nicely cooked and in much better condition than they might have been if Nineveh hadn't been sacked by the enemy. However, some of them were in such ferocious heat, like this example, that the clay had begun to bubble and to vitrify, to turn into a kind of glass material, which gives you an idea of the flames. Never mind that. How much time have we got here? William, hello, William. Sorry to disturb you.
I've been tweeting.
How much time do we have?
We have...
Another half an hour. Oh, well, then, no problem, no problem. Okay. This tablet here in front of you, I hope everybody's still awake. Are you all awake and everything? Yeah, okay. Just checking. Yeah. This tablet here is about the size of a matchbox. And if you saw it in the street, you probably wouldn't even stop to pick it up. But it is something of a kind of volcanic importance, because it was written by a theologian in Babylon in about 600 BC when Nebuchadnezzar was king of Babylon. And it's a theological document, and this is how it works. Some thoughtful scribe who is immersed in the practice of daily religion had an idea that Marduk, who was the main god of Babylon, the god of Nebuchadnezzar, and the god of the whole country, and the chief god, he had the idea that instead of being the most important god among a whole room full of them, that there should be a new way of looking at it, where all the other powerful gods were not independent any longer, but they were kind of aspects of Marduk. There was a shift in their perception, so that the god of the sun, who is in charge of justice, then becomes Marduk with regard to justice, and the god of warfare becomes Marduk with regard to warfare. So you have a kind of synthesizing process which takes a very ancient polytheistic religion and recasts it into a monotheistic frame. And this is a very unexpected matter and has a lot of bearing on the whole question of the rise of monotheism within modern religions of Judaism, Islam, and Christianity. This is an ancestral part of the development of this conception. So, does anybody know what this is? Yes. It's the Cyrus cylinder. This is the Cyrus cylinder. This is the most remarkable thing too. It was written by King Cyrus, the second king of Persia, when he conquered Babylon, good and proper. And that was the end of the native Babylonian dynasty and a whole new world under Achaemenid supervision. Now, this infamous or famous cylinder has made a lot of noise all over the world, and it's like a snowball going down a snowy hill, because it gets bigger and bigger and bigger, and the snowball inside it gets harder and harder to see. But this thing was found in Babylon, buried under a wall in the 19th century. It came to light. And it's a very clever piece of political propaganda, whereby Cyrus had the job of persuading the Babylonians that it was okay to have a Persian on the throne of their country. Quite a difficult matter. And he did it by declaring himself to be a worshipper of the national Babylonian god and doing everything that a good Babylonian should do. And this message was buried in a wall. Sometime towards the end of the last century, a lot of people claimed that this object was the first charter of human rights. And the reason for it is that in the Bible, Cyrus gave permission for the exiles in Babylon to go back to Jerusalem, as is described in the Bible, with all the prophets and so forth. And so this idea from the Bible was associated with this cylinder. It's the same king, the same occasion, but it has no reference whatsoever to any of that stuff. So I want to tell you something secret. You mustn't tell anybody else about this. But this cylinder, as well as being very famous, has this famous characteristic built into it that it's unique. And everybody celebrates the fact that this is a unique historical document. Now, that's a kind of bizarre matter if a unique historical document is buried out of sight of anybody who can never read it again. And in the British Museum, not so long ago, we made a rather interesting discovery. You see these scrappy pieces of tablet on the screen? Well, the one on the right is the front and back of the same tablet, and the one on the left is just a little flake. In a box in the British Museum, these pieces came to light quite unexpectedly. One of them was found by my professor Lambert on the day before New Year's Eve, and the other one was found by me about 4 days later. And these little fragments come from a second copy of this so-called unique inscription. So this was rather important because it got rid of the idea that anything from antiquity could ever be unique. It's a stupid conception and unsubstantiated under any circumstances. But what happened was this. It had been agreed in the museum to lend the Cyrus cylinder to Tehran on exhibition. And there'd been a lot of discussion about it. It was rather complicated. And just about the time it was going to leave, just about when it was going to be packed, these two fragments came to light. And they threw so much light on the problem of what the cylinder was about that we had to delay the loan. And everybody thought that we made these up and they didn't really exist. And we got into lots of hot water. Now, To go back to the question of Nebuchadnezzar, this is one of the largest inscriptions that's ever been found. It's carved into stone. It's about this big by this big. It's very heavy indeed. And it's known as the East India House inscription. And the reason is that a tea clipper arrived in London with a lot of ballast on board, and all the heavy things were taken out and put on the quayside, and somebody realized that this one had writing on it. And so very early in the 18th century, this came to us. And it's a marvelous thing, because Nebuchadnezzar, who was a bit like Akbar himself, he was king of the world, he had the greatest capital in the world, and he rebuilt it. He wrote this inscription to explain all his building program. But the most interesting thing about it is this. He didn't write it in conventional contemporary writing. He wrote out the whole inscription in archaic writing, so that when you saw it, it looked like it was written hundreds and hundreds of years ago. And the reason is that he had this understanding that if people saw an inscription of the king in ancient writing, then they would kind of instinctively understand that the dynasty had lasted forever before and would last forever into the future. It was a kind of way of ensuring permanence. And there's a more common modern example of this. For example, if you go to Oxford on a visit and you're walking down the high street about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, you might feel like a cup of tea. And if you look up and down the street, there'll be 12 or 13 establishments where you can get one, and one of them for sure will say, "Ye oldie tea shoppy," in old-fashioned writing. And what happens is, something inside your psychology, not inside your stomach or your brain, says to yourself this: well, if they've been making cream teas for 500 years, they must be pretty good by now, so why don't we go in there? And this is exactly the same kind of mechanism used by the great king in all that time. And how did they do that? How did they possibly do writing from an earlier time? Well, there were some learned scholars who worked in the temple who made a practice of collecting ancient inscriptions and making lists of them and putting next to them the modern signs that were used at the time. So you can perhaps see that the larger signs are still pictographic. There's a sign for water, which is a bit of a river. There's a bird and so forth. So they knew themselves that their writing 3,000 years before had been of this kind, and they made an effort to identify sign for sign with modern writing, so that if the king said, "Look, here's the text, I want you to put it into ancient signs," they could use this dictionary and look them up and produce an ancient text. Rather clever. Now, this unappetizing piece of crud is a brick from Babylon, part of one of Nebuchadnezzar's buildings. And you will see perhaps in the middle there is a panel which has been squashed flat by a stamp. And the thing is, it says, "I am Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, the greatest king in the world. Look ye upon my monuments and marvel," or something to that effect. And every other brick or so in all the city buildings had this stamp in the middle. It's the most common inscription. And in this case, one of the workmen who wrote Aramaic himself wrote his name, completely unimpressed by the fact it was the king's brick. Presumably he was having lunch, eating a sandwich, and he wrote his name in Aramaic writing on the brick too, which survived just as long. Now, one of the great delights of working in a museum like the one in London is that members of the public come in with objects for investigation and description. And bricks of Nebuchadnezzar come in very often because of the history of interference in the Middle East. Lots of families have one on a bookshelf or on a mantelpiece. It's not an uncommon matter. I must have seen 300 of them since I've been in the museum. So the thing is, one day about 15 years ago, a lady came in and sat down at the other side of the desk from me, and she started to remove a brick from her shopping bag. And I said, "Oh, I can read that. It says Nebuchadnezzar." And Most people find it rather surprising that you can read this script at all, but it's even more surprising if you can read it when it's covered with bananas. So she was taken aback by the fluidity of my translation, so she put it on the desk and I looked at it in a cursory way, expecting it to be fully intelligible. And there was something rather peculiar, because you can see there are three lines of writing. Some of the signs were upside down. And I've never seen that before. And when writing is upside down, it's usually made by a forger who doesn't know better. But this was obviously a real thing. So, scratch the head, what can it be? And there's only one possible explanation, that the brick stamp which produced the stamped inscription, of course, is carved back to front so that it makes a legible text. But the one used here must have had signs that could be taken out of a frame when it was clogged up with clay after repeated use and washed under the tap, so to speak, and reset in the matrix to start again. And on some occasion, somebody put one of the rows in upside down and stamped a few bricks before it was noticed. Now, that's a small episode on a sunny afternoon sometime in the 6th century BC. But the amazing thing from our point of view is this is movable type. The Babylonians invented movable type, and the only use they put it to was stamping bricks. They could have made another little leap and Gutenberg would have been out of work. And finally, I have to show you something really miraculous. This is a school tablet from near the end of the period when cuneiform was used. It actually lasted to the 1st century AD. This is probably about the 3rd century, 4th century BC, something like that. It's a school tablet. We have thousands of them. And you can see there are columns of writing. And what it is this. It comes from a world where Babylonian writing is still used and where the Babylonian language is still used. But side by side with it on the streets of Babylon, people were speaking Aramaic and writing Aramaic in an alphabet. And gradually, Aramaic became more and more common in the Middle Eastern world. And this object is from just this time when it was happening. So you see the inscription at the bottom. I've put it in yellow for people whose cuneiform is a bit rusty. So if you read out loud these signs going down the column, it says A B G D A E U Z A H E T U Y A K A L A M E N U S A A Y A N U P E T U K U R I S H I T A. So this, when I was at school, used to be called the alphabet. These are the sounds of the Aramaic letters, like Alpha, Beta, Gamma, Delta in Greek, or Aleph, Beit, Gimel, Dalet in Hebrew, or also in Arabic. This is the same order as the alphabet, and these are the sounds of the Aramaic language, which people used at home, but didn't normally write down. And so what must have happened is this. The teacher one day thought that the class was not very attentive, and he would give them a really good idea for something experimental. So he said, what I want you to do, you all know the Aramaic alphabet, I want you to find a cuneiform sign for each one and write them down the column. So they found one for R, one for B, one for G, one for Da. So this is very interesting because it shows a functional bilingual situation, stress-free, with no real harsh border between the two sides. It shows that the alphabet ran in the same order as we know later, but it shows something else as well, because A, B, G, and Da are not the names of the letters, they are the sounds of the letters. And it seems to me this, that, for example, in England, no children at school ever get taught to read and write. It doesn't happen at school. So it's usually the family who have to take over and make good the deficit. And if you teach small children to read and write, it's no good giving them the names of the letters. You make the sounds of the letters until they can do it. So A is for apple and P is for Peter and so forth. So this is the natural way of learning an alphabet by sound. But we can see from this tablet that side by side with that idea that these letters also had names like Aleph, Alpha, Beta, Gamma, Delta in Greek. they had the names of the letters as well. How do we know this? Well, the first letter in the alphabet is Aleph, or something like that, R. And so they used the syllable R. When they got to Ayin, Ayin is also pronounced R, but they couldn't write R a second time because they'd already used R for Aleph. So when they got to that point after May, Nu, Sa, and they got to the next R, which is Ayin, they gave it the name. They wrote Ayanu in the tablet, which shows that all these letters had posh names as well as simple sounds. So this is the important point about all this nonsense. This is the important point, that if you study this stuff, it may look to you mad, it may look to you insane, but the truth of the matter is that this is a divine gift for mankind, that we have all this material where we can encounter people close face to face, because what comes out of these extremely unappetizing things is Homo sapiens, as we recognize Homo sapiens, and all the characteristics of which we're so proud, like meanness, adultery, lies, hypocrisy, scandal, all those normal human achievements are liberally sprinkled throughout these documents, as well as kindliness, saintliness, being good parents, writing poetry, listening to songs. All the stuff is there. The whole lot is in these tablets. Thank you. Yeah. Okay. William, I'm sorry to disturb you, but I think I need some help.
No, come and sit there.
Can you?
Irving, that was absolutely spectacular. Triumph of. He was only asked to do this morning, so I think we need a particularly loud round of applause for Irving coming up with this at such short notice, putting together a PowerPoint instantly. One question, slight sort of tangent. How serious in the final scheme of things for Iraq studies has been the destruction wrought by ISIS on their remains relative to, say, the looting of Baghdad after the fall of the city at the time of Saddam, when the Americans weren't looking?
Well, all of this destruction, there's no answer to this question. All of this destruction leaves people like me who work in museums unable to say anything. I mean, it's a well-known matter that when you have a surprise or a shock, you are speechless. All writers say speechless with astonishment. This is speechlessness per se. What can one possibly say about a principle which runs in the face and contradicts everything to do with civilization? And the British Museum is a kind of massive lighthouse which celebrates just all those things: freedom of thought, freedom of access, shared information, lack of racism, the history of the world, what mankind is capable of. That's what we do. So all that stuff is like a massive affront to everybody in the building. Let me tell you, we are all, as I explained the other day, trained killers. We all have 19th century or 18th century muskets loaded with gunpowder. And when the whistle blows, we will defend the property against anything that comes up the steps.
But what do you feel when you see one of these guys with pneumatic drills going at an Assyrian bull? That terrible video they produced of all those Elamite masks crashing to the ground. And
you know, I'm extremely touched and appreciative that you're asking me this question in front of 500,000 people. I mean, the truth of the matter is most curators cried when they found out about it, when they really believed what was going on. What can you possibly say? All we can do is this. In the museum, we have a project to bring young curators and archaeologists from Iraq for long periods of high-powered training on forensic collection of fragments and damaged material and the restoration of them in the most modern possible way. So,
and you've started that program already?
Yes, and the government has actually funded it, and over the next 3.5 years, about 30 people will come bit by bit and have this training, and we will equip them with everything. So all we can do is look to when it's over and to make good as much as possible. That's all we can do.
During the looting of the Baghdad Museum, I mean, what sort of proportion of stuff was lost? 50%, 80%?
Well, you know, that's something that nobody ever knew, but it was a very high percent, and nobody actually was in a position to say. For example, you perhaps know this, that in museums it's sometimes it's sometimes detectable that there are objects in the museum which are not listed on a list. It does happen once in a while, and I think there were parts of the collection where there was no reference available afterwards to establish exactly what had been taken. The interesting thing was that some of the Iraqi officials who came to talk to us about it said that when that was died down, they issued a moratorium that anybody who had antiquities could bring them back with no questions asked, and they set up a large table in the museum for this purpose, and all sorts of things came back. About three quarters of them had never been in the museum in the first place, so that was quite interesting. I didn't make this clear, but my whole point in giving this talk this afternoon was this: to get rid of computers completely, probably to get rid of typewriters, certainly to get rid of pencils, and to go back to basics, and all schools in this country, like in Britain, should be using clay tablets and styluses. I feel very strongly about it, and once I was on the radio, on Radio 4, giving a Sunday afternoon talk about cuneiform, and I ended it up, because it was a bit heavy going, by saying, when I'm Prime Minister, which of course is just around the corner, when I am appointed Prime Minister, there's going to be a big change, and cuneiform will be introduced in school with this kind of writing, because we need a lot of people to help the cuneiform army to make progress with all the inscriptions in the British Museum. So that was the end of the programme. Then the music came in, and I had a cup of tea. But the following morning, I'm sitting at my desk, there's a phone call comes. Hello, Dr. Finkel. Oh, this is the front desk. We've got three volunteers for the army turned up. And what is really interesting, is of course I went down there in the most sycophantic way and put scarves around their necks and all that stuff, but one of them went to Oxford and did a degree in Assyriology on the basis of that stupid remark. So bit by bit, we will make progress.
I remember once visiting the site of Ugarit in Syria, and they claimed that was the place where the alphabet was invented. Is that?
Well, they do that because they want to sell you books. Nobody quite knows when the alphabet was invented, but we know roughly, and we know why, and we know how. But
was it in Ugarit?
Pardon?
Was it in Ugarit?
Well, they had an alphabet in Ugarit, but it's not quite the ancestral to the one we have today. This is a horribly complicated matter. I hate people asking it. What do you keep asking me all these terrible questions for? I come here at the last minute, there's a cock-up, I think of some goddamn lecture, I stand up in front of half the world, I give a talk, and you ask me about sacking monuments for one thing? I mean, this is anathema to me. Let me be blunt. It's appalling what's happened to this stuff. Okay, I tell you.
Right. So, I think I get it. That's enough questions from me. Over to you guys in the front row here. Time for two questions.
First, my compliment. You are the most handsome person that I've ever seen. You look like...
But you're the most handsome person he's ever seen.
You are like Bernard Shaw. You look like Bernard Shaw.
You look now, like Bernard Shaw.
My question now...
Oh, I thought that was all you wanted. It's fine by me if you stop there. I mean, you can't improve on it, so...
Okay. My question is, when the Homo sapiens started, what was their first language? Homo sapiens, first language.
That's a very, very important question. And I don't think, unless we get this time machine, this will ever be answered. So the first writing, as I said, is about 3,300 BC, the very first of this cuneiform stuff. And that's the first evidence. So before that, it's all silent. Unless somebody one day excavates something earlier with other writing, this could always happen. But it would never go back to that period. Because... on the border of Homo sapiens, when they first emerged as human beings, there must have been a time when language and grammar was part of the force that drove the evolution forward. Because, for example, you're a bulky, large, violent-looking caveman. I see an example here. So we have someone like that. And we're trying to communicate before there's any language. One of the first things you do is to clarify between you that your name is William and my name is Irving, and it might be Grunt 1 and Grunt 2, but I imagine it like this, that at the point in evolution when speech first began, the benefits of it must have been so intense when there was a moment of understanding that each time there was a moment of understanding, things must have leapt forward very quickly. So once you understand, I think, the difference between me and you have the beginnings of, singular, plural, them, us, wife, female, everything will follow on. So I see it like this, that they must have lumbered about. I don't know what they did in those days. Climbing trees and eating bananas and things. When things got to the state when the circumstances, the chemistry meant that it was going to be another move forward, I think it was very quick. And when that happened, we have thousands and thousands of years of language which we'll never recover. Never recover. And it's a tragic thing. I'm a great believer in this time issue. I keep talking about it. But somebody seriously suggested that the authorities of the Jaipur Literary Festival had a time machine available for scholarship. So I don't know where it's parked, but I think that's the only way forward to solve these things.
Lady here.
Thank you, Professor. That was a fantastic talk. Incidentally, I'm a docent at the National Museum in New Delhi. My question to you is that taking it nearer home, we have the Harappan script and that banner that is seen in Mohenjo-daro. So do you have any comments or do you have any insights about it?
Why has it not been decoded? Why is it so difficult?
Well, we can explain that very simply because there are many inscriptions, but they're all small and they all have a small number of characters and they are all on seals with one exception. And the thing about it is they almost certainly write the name of the owner. So from all the other material we can compare it with, it either has the owner's name, or it has the owner's name and his father's name, or the owner's name and his profession. It can't really be anything else because they are clearly personal seals. So if you establish that, and you have four or five signs, and that's the most to play with, the best way to understand why no one has translated it is this. If you took a telephone directory, let's say you were a Martian philologist, you came to England, it was a quiet weekend, everybody was at home, and all you could find was a telephone directory, and you went home with it, you could never establish anything about the language of the people because it's just their names. And if you had no clue for how the signs work, there's nothing to start with.
So what's the scale of the contact between Indus Valley and India and the guys you're talking about, your Babylonians?
Well, there's very clear evidence that there was trading between Sumer in southern Iraq in the middle of the third millennium and the Mohenjo-daro, the Indus Valley settlements. Not only is it established, but even in the sense of writing, because in Ur, in southern Iraq, some seals were found in Mesopotamia which had Indus Valley inscriptions on, the same kind of thing. And something very interesting was discovered, because there's a Finnish Indologist called Simo Parapola, and he decided, like all Assyriologists, no one's deciphered this Indus Valley, I better do it one afternoon, that kind of idea. So the first thing he did was to use the computer to write in all the inscriptions, because then you have control of them. And they couldn't get anywhere except this point, that they established statistically that of all the signs, some are often found in conjunction, some are sometimes found in conjunction, and some never. And there are enough of them for this to be a significant point. So in other words, they had an idea that if you were writing this stuff, there were some things you never did for one reason or another. Now, when Parpola looked at the seals from Ur, there weren't very many of them, but in two cases, there were signs juxtaposed, which in Indus Valley would never have happened. So he came to the conclusion, and I agree with him, that for some funny reason, the script, the Indus script, was being used to write names in Mesopotamia which were different from their own names. They had funny letters. You know, like in Indian languages, you have DH. I don't know what DH is supposed to be. Everybody knows D is D and H is H. Same kind of problem. So they must have used the script improvising in order to record a sound they wouldn't normally do. So that, to me, proves that it's a phonetic script. That's the most important thing. So in other words, each of those signs had its value. So maybe sooner or later, from Dolavira, there was a long panel, was there not, with an inscription. And we all thought, jolly good. Good stuff, jolly good. But next time, perhaps you can find one with a translation underneath into Sumerian. Then we can read everything.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise to your feet and give a standing ovation to Irving Finkel, who's given one of the great lectures of this festival.